Sabbath, church. It's good to see you. Good to be back. I bring you greetings from your sister churches not too far from here. It's good to see you all. From the earliest days of antiquity, men sought the favor of the gods. In their desperation, they brought them the price of their redemption and their blessing and sold themselves into their service. The price was a devotion driven by fear. They paid with food, money, animal sacrifices, and even with self-mutilation and human blood. All in the hopes that their crops would be bountiful, that their lives would be met with success, and that they might enter into an afterlife of bliss. They flocked to their temples to give them the prerequisite of their peace and security. See with me in your mind Marduk's Babylonian ziggurat stretching to heaven. See the high places dedicated to Baal in Canaan, the Philistine sanctum where Dagon presided, the temples of Egypt paying homage to Ra and Osiris and Isis. See Mount Olympus, the dwelling place of Zeus and the Greek pantheon. Gaze down the corridors of time. View the blood spilled in the Colosseum for the glory of Rome and her gods. Glance at the Mayan and Aztec pyramids where human beings were sacrificed. Observe the animists in Europe and Africa, Asia, and the Americas, worshiping nature, clinging to superstition and witchcraft. Now, perceive with me the great world religions of our day. Look at their wise men, their prophets, their gurus, who are viewed by their followers as superior to those ancient pagan gods. Men like Zoroaster, Krishna, Buddha, Muhammad, Baha'u'llah. Imagine for a moment that they and all those deities are gathered together all in one place and at one time. Now into the fray, see as one more enters. He has the dark features of a Middle Easterner. He looks like a humble carpenter, but he carries himself with a noble bearing, hinting at his true dignity. Into the arena of the gods enters Jesus of Nazareth. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we ask today that Jesus might be lifted up in our midst. Amen. In 1993, the Parliament of the World's Religions met together in Chicago to have a summit on faith. Leaders from all over the world, representing every major world religion, came to stand together on a consensus. They argued that in order for the world to experience peace and harmony, the world's major religions must unite. There was to be no more claims to exclusive truth. All religions were now to be seen as coming from one source. All were spokes on the same wheel, leading to the same place. In the same spirit of the Parliament of the World's Religions, the famous historian Arnold Toynbee once predicted that the governments of the world would unite either by force or federation, but that the unity could not succeed without a universal religion. Christianity, he said, should be purged of its sinful state of mind, namely, its exclusivism. But can we remain Christian and give up Jesus Christ as the exclusive way to eternal life? One question that we must ask is this: is Jesus really their peer? Is Jesus really their equal? I want to posit to you today, church, that there are three things that separate Jesus Christ from all other gods. Number one, his divine nature. Number two, his sinless life. And number three, his resurrection. Jesus Christ had a divine nature, church. He is the only historical God-man. In 1 Timothy 3:16, the Bible tells us, without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on the world, received up into glory. Amen. He's speaking of Jesus Christ. Philippians 2, 5 through 11 says this, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, in the form of who? The form of God. Jesus Christ is God himself, Paul is telling us. He says he thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in the earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. Jesus Christ is Lord. Colossians 1, 14 through 17 says, in whom, speaking of Jesus, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature, for by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist. What we find out from the word of God is that Jesus was no ordinary man. He was no ordinary religious leader. Looking into the face of Jesus, we are looking into the face of God Almighty. He is no ordinary man. Truly, when Jesus steps into the arena of the gods, he shows them all to be imposters, a sham, a counterfeit. But this isn't the only evidence that we have. The second is that his was the only sinless life. Mention the requirement of sinlessness, and the religious field clears. Only one man is left standing. John 8, 46, Jesus said with his own words, which of you convicts me of sin? And if I tell the truth, why do you not believe me? 1 Peter 2:22. Peter, a man who lived with Jesus day in and day out for 3.5 years, who observed every moment with Jesus, he says this, he committed no sin, nor was deceit found in his mouth. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says that God the Father made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. What does that even mean? To never sin. You and I are so used to sin in our lives. We struggle with the outward act of sin. But understand that sin goes deep down into the core of who you are. It's in your thoughts. It's in your dispositions and attitudes. It's in your temperament. It's in your mood. It's in your motives. In its purest form, it is self-centeredness. He was completely untainted by it. He was unmoved by it. He had strength where we are weak. He had confidence where we find ourselves insecure. He had complete emotional, psychological, and physical health in the midst of people who were emotional, psychological, and physical wrecks. He never formed a false opinion about himself or about other people. He was fully liberated to be who he truly was, himself. No one ever made him doubt who he was. No one ever hurt his self-esteem. Never did he have a cognitive distortion, church. His thoughts were always on point. His perspective was always accurate. He was never self-deceived. He was never deceived by other people either. The Bible says he had no need that anyone should testify of man, for he knew what was in man. He had perfect discernment. No one could ever pull a fast one over on him. He understood people's motives better than they understood their own motives. He said, For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. In spite of knowing the dirt on everyone, he loved them all. He was strong in the face of opposition. They conspired to destroy his ministry and murder him, and he confronted them on it without fear. He understood the mysteries of the universe. His mind could comprehend any study. Nothing was too difficult for him. He could have made a name for himself as some scientist or in business or as a politician or pursued any other career, but he only pursued one thing, God's will for his life. He invented a job thereby that only he could ever accomplish, Savior of the world. Colossians 2:15 says that having disarmed spiritual principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, trying over them in it. These spiritual principalities and powers that it's referring to is Satan's kingdom. And so we find that Jesus was the only human being to go into direct conflict with Satan and win. He was never confused about what the right thing was to do. His ethic was always impeccable. He always knew his purpose. He was never enslaved by vice. He never once formed a bad habit. Never suffered from a poor decision that he made, only by the poor decisions of others. Not one sin can be made to stick against his account. Every thought, every word, every action of Jesus Christ was exactly what God would think, say, and do. What of his personality? He never complained. He never said a mumbling word. He never said bad things about people behind their backs, even though they were saying bad things about him behind his. He knew the dirt on everyone, like I said, yet he was never negative about them. He was always an optimist because he believed and knew who they were designed to be. He had a kind word and look for everyone. Though he was the majesty of heaven, he did not proclaim his exalted character and claim the reverence which rightly belonged to him, but he traversed the earth weary, hungry, and often sad because men did not feel their need of the blessings he came to give them. He was humble and meek. We are told in Christ Triumphant, page 228, that as a child, he was firm and steadfast in his purpose to do the right. Though others tried to lead him to do evil, yet he never did wrong and would not turn away in the least from the path of truth and right. He always obeyed his parents and did every duty that lay in his path. He was respectful. We find even at the very end of his life, when he resurrected from the grave and he had a date with his Father in heaven, that he folded his clothes neatly. He was clean. He smelled good. He was presentable. He always made his bed and folded his clothing, apparently, even after he rose from the dead. He was fit. If you wanted to hang out with Jesus, you were going to get in shape, weren't you? He took care of his body. He always rose early and had his prayer and devotion time. He does this in Mark chapter 1, even after doing over 16 hours of ministry the day before. He was compassionate. He had a healthy sense of humor. He was down to earth. Everyone was comfortable in his presence, as if they were totally loved and accepted. He made people feel as if they were the only person in the world when they spoke to him. He was loyal, even when Peter denied him. He went to the cross for Peter. He cared more about others than he did for himself. The third thing that we find about Jesus is that he conquered the grave. In Acts 17, verses 30 to 31, Paul says this: truly, These times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man he has ordained. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. In 1 Corinthians 15, 20-22, he says, but now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the firstfruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. Jesus took a degenerate body, the same body that you and I have inherited, and lived such a perfect life in it that when it died, he brought it back from death because death could not hold him. This is the ultimate proof that he is who he says he is. Jesus has resurrection power. And the last thing that I want you to know, church, is that this Jesus, this Savior, is touched by your weaknesses. He felt it all. Sweat, blood, tears, fatigue, frustration, loneliness, being misunderstood, misinterpreted, misread. It says he was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. He still knows how that feels. And yet he pursues out of love. And even though he is turned away 1,000 times, he continues to pursue. Yet he never resorts to Luciferian methods to entice, to manipulate. The rejection and mistreatment wound him deeper than anyone can imagine. Hebrews 2:18 says, for in that he himself has suffered, being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted. Hebrews 4:15 says, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses. Have you ever felt weak? Have you ever struggled to overcome a tendency in your life that you still don't have the victory over? Jesus understands what it feels like to be tempted. Jesus understands what it feels like to be in that flesh that you have. Jesus can feel what you are feeling right now, every moment of your life. He has been inside of your thoughts, your emotions, your feelings. He is acquainted with them all. To the person who has been abandoned by their family or by their lover, by their spouse, Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? He understands what it feels like. To the person who is in shackles in prison and can't get out of either the physical prison around them or the prison of their mind in their depression, Jesus was placed into shackles. Jesus was placed into prison. To the person who is being ridiculed or taunted for who they are, Jesus has been there. They spit in his face. They pulled out his beard. To the person who is longing for their child, their wayward child, Jesus tells us the story of the prodigal son so we can understand how he feels over his wayward ones. To the person who is struggling and beset in their lives, I want you to know Jesus is on your side. Jesus loves you. Jesus feels what you're going through. And Jesus cares more than anyone. He has an offer to us. Colossians 1:25-29 says, Paul says this, whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God which is given to me for you, to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus, whereunto I also labor, striving according to his working, which worketh in me mightily. Colossians 2, 9 through 10, he goes on to say, "For in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, who is the head of all principality and power." Jesus, Paul is telling us, wants to go deep inside of you and fill all of your weak, hurting, and empty places. I've heard a definition of sin, which I like. It says, sin is trying to get an unmet need met in the wrong way. We all have unmet needs, and we're all trying to get those needs met. And we're going to finite things to get them met. Paul tells us, in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. He is infinite. Your spouse, your girlfriend, your boyfriend, your love interest cannot fully fulfill your heart's longing for love. No human being on this planet can. Your parents cannot. That longing for that someone, that special someone, was implanted into you when you were formed in your mother's womb. And it is a God-shaped void that only Jesus can fill. He wants to be so close to you that you can hear him speaking to you from the inside. This is what he's offering. Colossians 2:15, our starting verse, says, "Having disarmed spiritual principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it." Jesus did this for you and me. He defeated Satan. He defeated sin so that we could be free. Philippians 2:10 to 11 says that at the knee of Jesus, every knee shall bow. The day will come, brothers and sisters, when every knee will bow, not before Zeus, not before Marduk, not before any other religious leader, but before Jesus Christ. So behold your King. Behold your God. Behold your Savior. This is the God we adore, our faithful, unchanging friend, whose love is as great as his power and knows neither limit nor end. Will you come to him today? Will you make the total sacrifice, the total offering of your life to him? Will you praise him with your life? Will you worship him with your life? Will you confess him with your life? Will you trust in him with your life? If this is your desire, then I implore you, church, talk to him. Just like you would talk to a friend. Pour out your heart to him. Cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. Come to Jesus. Enter into his rest. If you are running without direction or destination, enter into his rest. If you are tired of falling despite your many attempts, enter into his rest. If you are sick and tired of being sick and tired, enter into his rest. Enter into his rest and be free. God bless you. Behold, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me to give to everyone according to his work. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, the bright and morning star. He who testifies to these things says, surely I am coming quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.